Gather in this service of worship and celebration, we remember among us God's promise of life. When we were baptized in Jesus Christ, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. It is with this promise before us that we are able to commend her to God's eternal care. And in that spirit, we come now to worship. And I'll ask you to turn in your hymnals. The entrance hymn is not on the screen, the PowerPoint, so you have to turn in your hymnals to 174. The verses that we'll sing are on the screen. You may be seated. The slide prior to the prelude said this: death is God carrying us in one arm while the other flings aside heaven's door to welcome us back to the blazing hearth of our first home, while those inside, having arrived before us, rush to the door, like glad children shouting, "They're here, they're here. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us in this place and in this time. Blessed is God, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation, who comforts us when sorrow surrounds us, so that we might also comfort others.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Marcia. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. And, O God, you have boundless compassion. And in that compassion, console us who mourn. Give us your help, your grace, your hope, so we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our own course, our own faith life on earth in confidence and assurance until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Death has a bad name on earth, but in heaven it's a homecoming party. Every time the door opens, God does not forget those earthbound children, sad and left behind. God leaves the party early to enter into their despair, to get them ready for their own parties someday. Before I read the obituary, which Marcia wrote, I just want to make give a couple comments. Some of you last night were able to do that, share your own story and of your own interaction with her in your life. Marcia and I were in seminary together 20-some years ago, and she wore sandals back then. Yes, in fact. Neil and I were talking about that yesterday afternoon at the funeral home, just a minute. But yes, she's worn sandals even 20-some years ago. There is a class that we took in seminary. It's called Systematic Theology. In that class, you have to systematize your thoughts. You have to, if you think about God, and it's A, you know, idea A, then it would logically follow idea B, and then idea C, and then idea D. The purpose of the class is to organize your own thoughts. That's why it's called systematic and theology. Marcia wrote just a couple months ago a paper called Why I Believe. And I think it fits so well with that systematizing of our thoughts, because as I was reading that, It gives me and her family why she believed what she believed. And I think that's important for all of us, to write down our thoughts, not only when we are given a terrible diagnosis, but it helps us see what we think, why we think what we think. And I won't go into that or comment on that anymore, but I just thought of Marcia's writing that those thoughts. It's 5 pages long, and why she believed what she believed about God and life and family and all of those kinds of things. Well, Marcia Lynn Pyle, beloved wife, loved wife, mother, daughter, sister, friend, and pastor. Marcia is survived by her husband, Neil Anderson, daughters Jody, Deb Lawson, Karnick, Hannah Anderson, and Elisha Ryan Moody, parents Ernest and Betty Lou Pyle, brothers Kenneth, Sandra, Richard, Natalie, Gerald, Barbara, and Robert Anne, and a large extended family. Marcia served as associate pastor of Christ Lutheran Church in Menominee, Wisconsin from 1986 to 1991, and as senior pastor at First Lutheran Church in Amory, Wisconsin from 1991 up to her retirement for health reasons in February of 2005. She leaves a legacy of indomitable energy and selfless caring, reminding all of us who loved her that we are God's agents in this world, and there is much we can do to make a difference. Following a 17-month battle with ovarian cancer, Marcia passed away peacefully at home on September 8th, surrounded by her family at the age of 52 years, 8 months, and 15 days. May God bless her memory to those of us who live beyond her. I also want to announce that there is lunch following immediately for those of you who do not go out to the cemetery in the fellowship hall, which is out in this direction. I also want to thank the family on behalf of First Lutheran Church for sharing Marcia with this church and the larger church, the church at large. Families sacrifice a great deal when the mom or spouse is a pastor, being on call 24/7 and running here and running there and doing this and doing that. And so on behalf of this church, I want to thank the family, you, Neil, and girls, women, for sharing Marcia with us. Thank you. I will call on our Bishop of our Northwest Synod of Wisconsin, Bob Berg.
Thank you, Pastor. Neil and Jody, Hannah, Alicia, Mr. and Mrs. Pyle, and brothers Kenneth and Richard and Gerald and Robert. I come before you today representing the Northwest Synod of Wisconsin and 211 congregations and 106,000 baptized, as well as the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. I come before you to offer our deepest sympathy at the death of Marcia, but also a word of thanks, as Pastor Mike has already mentioned, for her ministry, for the ways in which God used Marcia to impact the lives of others. The one thing I appreciated as a kind of a point of personal privilege here about Marcia is I got to know her and walked into the office again today where she and I had visits. And I thought, you know, the one thing about Marcia is that I never had to worry about what Marcia was thinking. Because she always told me. And what a gift that was as a bishop, as someone who was a partner in ministry with a pastor. You know, I didn't have to worry, well, Marcia's going to tell me something because she knows I want to hear that. She would be very honest, and that's a gift, and I really, really did appreciate that gift in her. I want my words to be very brief today. Again, my main reason is to extend sympathy and a word of thanks to all of you. However, knowing Marcia and thinking about what I might want to share from God's word this day, I found a text in Paul's letter to the Ephesians that I think in the first part of it describes who Marcia thought she was and knew she was as a servant of Jesus Christ. And then even in her dying time, as we were able to share communion and have conversation, Marcia wasn't done communicating the message. I mean, I walked in and was blessed by my time with her, as often happens to pastors. So this reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians in chapter 3. And again, listen early on for how Marcia might describe herself, and then the word that she has for all of us gathered here today. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of this power. Although I'm the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ, and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God, who created all things, so that through the church the wisdom of God in its rich variety might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he's carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. I pray, therefore, that you may not lose heart over my sufferings for you. They are your glory. And then a message. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth takes his name. I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever.
Thank you very much. Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore.
Watches me. His eye is on the sparrow.
A reading from Isaiah chapter 49, beginning with verse 13. Sing for joy, O heavens, and exult, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his suffering ones. But Zion said, The Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursing child or show no compassion for the child of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. See, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. I'll ask you to join. The words are not on the screen to Jesus Loves Me, but we're just going to, Marcia just picked the first verse to sing. So we'll just sing that first verse of Jesus Loves Me. Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 22. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. We will sing You, Lord, and those words are on the screen.
I'm not going to ask you to stand for the reading of the gospel. It's quite long. most of an entire chapter from the Gospel of John. Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" Jews do not share things in common with the Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where are you going to get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one that you have now is, well, not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one who is speaking to you." Just then, the disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman. But no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. Cannot he be the Messiah?" So they left the city and went on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples said to one another, "Surely no one has brought him something to eat." And Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say, 4 months more, then comes the harvest?' But I tell you, Look around you and see. See how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life so that the sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true. One sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I have ever done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." This is the gospel of our Lord. Before proceeding further, I feel I should say something about who I am, since I am a stranger to the majority of you, I'm sure, and you're wondering, why is this person in your pulpit? I married into this wonderful family many years ago. My mother-in-law is the twin sister of Marcia's mother. Betty Lou and Betty Jean Thompson girls, who went on to marry fellas who were cousins to each other, Harvey Pyle, my father-in-law, and Ernie Pyle. It's a tightly knit family when you're sort of united on both sides. And as I said last night at the funeral home, being an only child myself, I've really been adopted into this family, and I have been taken in and experienced the warmth and the care and the love of this wonderful family. And I want to thank you for allowing me to be here today. My wife Doris and my relationship with Neil and Marcia. Doris, of course, is Marcia's cousin. And we go back quite a ways. I had just come out of seminary when Neil and Marcia were getting married, and I had the honor and the privilege of preaching a sermon at their wedding. And later, when their first child, Hannah, was born, and I was in my first call, I had the rare honor and privilege of baptizing Hannah. My wife and I are her godparents. Neil and Marcia, godparents to our son. When Marcia went through seminary and was about to be ordained, she once again extended the honor and privilege to me of inviting me to preach at her ordination, and I'm forever grateful for that. A couple months ago, she told me when we visited her down in Rochester, she wasn't going to put me on the spot for this, but she called me a few days later and said she changed her mind. She was going to put me on the spot. So. Hence, you have me in your pulpit today. Please join me for a word of prayer. Gracious God, we gather together in loving memory, tears of rejoicing and sorrow, sounds of laughter and weeping, with an incredible flood of feelings in our hearts. Bless our feelings, bless our memories, bless our friendship, bless this time together that we may celebrate the life that was as we look forward together to the life to come. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Dear friends in Christ, grace and peace be yours from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. She was a feisty woman, one who could stand her ground in a man's world. She was a free thinker who did not bow easily to authority in any guise. She had an easy manner about her, and she had a way with words. She had a razor-sharp mind, and she was ready to match wits with the best of them. She made her own decisions, thank you. I'm talking, of course, about the woman at the well. Oh, were you thinking of someone else, perhaps? The connection is pretty obvious, isn't it, to any of us who knew Marcia. The association was clear to Marcia herself. After all, she's the one who chose this gospel to be read at her funeral. Just as she carefully selected and arranged all the other parts to this service of celebration. And we're not surprised. It was her way. It was her manner. It was true to her character. Fact is, like the woman at the well, Marcia was a person with a strong and independent spirit. It was evident in the way she lived. It was evident in the way she died, the way she faced dying. A woman of great faith, great faith. Marcia knew in her heart of hearts, I am convinced, that death only signaled a new dimension to her ongoing conversation with Jesus. And given the untimeliness of her departing, I would not be surprised if the Lord is doing some explaining right about now. Knowing Marcia, it had better be good. As for our knowing this remarkable woman of strength, faith, and integrity, and so many other virtues, each of us is gathered today to honor her memory today, and we've each been blessed to know her in a little different way, whether as wife, the mother, daughter, sister. Some of you were blessed to know Marcia her whole life long. Some of you remember the little girl growing up on the farm outside Castleton, North Dakota. Some of you were fortunate to grow up alongside her as family or friends or neighbors. Some of you here were blessed to know her as the Reverend Marcia Pyle. She probably wasn't too heavy on that reverend bit, but you knew her as Pastor Marcia, a colleague, pastor, caring counselor, wise teacher, inspiring preacher. By the way, she never needed no stinking pulpit, I think. She preached right from right from out there, didn't she? Some of us don't have quite the same gift. She was talented in so many ways. She sang like an angel. When I told my folks in my congregation down in Chicago that I was coming up here for Marcia's funeral, the immediate response from several people was, "You mean that tall woman with the beautiful voice who was here last Easter?" She had an eye for beauty and a way with fabrics, as Neil remarked about a week ago. I hope the Lord realizes heaven is about to be redecorated. If it's anything like the visual miracles that she did with this sanctuary during Advent and Easter seasons, the angels are sure to be delighted. As for myself, I was not blessed to know Marcia my whole life long. I got to know her when she was about 19. And she accompanied my wife, Doris, and me on one of our early trips to the Boundary Waters canoe area. We were back there recently, Doris and I, paddling over some of the same lakes. On Jackfish Bay, we went past a place that I remembered well from that trip back in the summer of 1972. It was a place that we had camped at near the end of the trip. The campsite stands out in my memory because of a couple of incidents involving Marcia. You know how some things stand out in your memory so that you never forget them? I can picture that campsite like it was yesterday. It was late evening after a hard day's paddle. We had just finished dinner, and we're about to hang our food pack over a tree branch when Doris yelled from back of our tents, "Bears!" A junior high English teacher at the time, I remember thinking immediately, gosh, that sounds suspiciously like the plural form of that noun. And sure enough, a few seconds later, two black bears came ambling into our campsite, a mother and what looked to be about a year old cub. Since they seemed not the least bit frightened by us, it seemed a prudent idea to me to hop in the canoe and paddle out a little ways and see what was happening. Doris didn't need any prompting to help drag the canoe into the water. But where was Marcia? "Marcia," we yelled, "get in the canoe." No response. Finally, she yells, "I'm coming, I'm coming." And we're all finally in the canoe and a few yards offshore. Doris and I asked simultaneously, "What took you so long?" Whereupon Marcia replied rather matter-of-factly, "I figured someone ought to finish hanging the food pack in the tree." And I said to myself, if I am ever in a really tight spot, I want this woman at my side. I know I'm not the only person in this room who has had that thought cross his or her mind. One of Marcia's great gifts was her level-headed, clear thinking. I suspect it made her a wonderful counselor. I know that she considered wise and compassionate counseling to be among the charismata, the spiritual gifts that God had so richly blessed her with. And I have no doubt that there are more than a few in this room right now who have benefited from that gift. There is so much to be grateful for, isn't there? There are so many blessings that spill over into the lives of others when a person recognizes the gifts that God has given her and freely shares those talents and abilities by ministering to others as Marcia did. Later on that same canoe trip, we were sitting around the campfire one evening. And we got to talking about what we each wanted to do with our lives. Marcia had just started college at St. Olaf, and she had her whole life in front of her. She was so smart, so talented, so good at so many things. "Do you have any idea what you want to do with your life, what you want to be?" we asked philosophically as we poked through the dying embers of a campfire. There was a long pause, and Marcia said, "I've been giving some thought about becoming a pastor." This was quite a ways before she actually went through with that. Also, this was 1972. There were no women pastors in the American Lutheran Church. Marcia knew better. Like that Samaritan woman in our gospel, the woman at the well, You see, Marcia had been in conversation with Jesus, and that changes everything. Jesus opens our eyes to see things we might otherwise miss. He opens our minds to possibilities we might otherwise miss. He opens our hearts to mission. The old distinctions give way, and there is no longer Jew or Gentile, male or female, slave or free, gay or straight. Jesus opens our eyes and our hearts to new possibilities. Like the woman at the well, Marcia was called to preach that message of hope, redemption, possibility, new life. And as with the woman at the well, Marcia's preaching has borne fruit. We have heard this woman of faith, and lives have been changed, enriched, turned around, given new eyes. Our world is better because she cared enough to tell us about Jesus. She cared enough to model that faith, to practice what she preached. That's what we're celebrating today, isn't it? That's what we're thanking and praising God for. Jesus sent this wonderful prophet and preacher and friend and companion into our midst, and we have so much to rejoice about, my friends. And we're doing it as Marcia would have us. There is, of course, another side to that same coin. A while back, I was listening to public radio as I was driving to work. They were airing a program about the ways in which we remember people when they die. The subject of eulogies came up, you know, the nice things we say about someone after they die. One of the commentators said that among the briefest but most eloquent eulogies he ever heard was delivered at the funeral of Jack Benny. Here's what the person said. Jack Benny used to joke, you know, often, that he was the stingiest man in the world. And now we know it's really true. He gave us 80 years, and it wasn't nearly enough. That's really the elephant in the room today, isn't it? Marcia gave us 52 years. It wasn't nearly enough. Not for you, Neil. Not for you, Hannah, Alicia, Jody. Not for you, Ernie, Betty Lou. Not for you, Ken, Dick, Jerry, Bob. Not for any of us who knew this woman and loved her. Marcia gave us 52 years. It wasn't nearly enough. The Lord's going to have some explaining to do for some of us, too, I think. In the meantime, though, we do have our memories. And what memories they are. That much was made abundantly clear last night at the funeral home. In an hour and a half of sharing, what wonderful stories about a wonderful woman and the lasting impact that she has had on our lives. I would simply advise you to treasure those memories, to keep them as a lasting gift from Marcia, a gift to you, and also to keep them and to treasure them as a place to which you can always go to be with Marcia. You know, Jesus tells his disciples toward the end of John's gospel in that part called the Farewell Discourse, In my Father's house there are many mansions. Remember that passage? In my Father's house there are many mansions. One of those mansions, I believe, is memory. If you wish to spend more time with Marcia, to keep the conversation going, as it were, you can always meet her in the mansion called memory. Being the detailed person she was, Marcia has even left a helpful guidebook, a sort of map to that mansion called memory, and I have the copy with me here. And it's called A Grandmother's Memories to Her Grandchild. By the way, I realize Marcia does not have any grandchildren yet. Take it as a hint, okay? If it applies to you. Actually, the collection of, they're all handwritten notes from Marcia herself. It's a delightful way for any of us to get to know her and to spend some quality time with her. Reading through it, I discovered that my wife, Doris, and myself are occupying a little niche in this mansion of memory. It's in a section called My Most Recent Trip. It's written sometime last spring. Marcia writes, my most recent trip was to visit Doris and Lloyd in Chicago. We saw Jody in Madison and Diane Olson in Milwaukee. We had a great time seeing everyone, and I got a bee in my bonnet to redecorate Doris and Lloyd's house. God knows someone needed to do it. This was last March, around Easter time. I gotta tell you, for a person coming off chemotherapy, someone literally at death's doorstep, she was a dynamo. Pictures were rehung. Hell, the refrigerator door had to be taken off and the hinges put on the other side so it would swing out the right way, the way Marcia thought it should swing out. Cabinets were bought and assembled. New lamps had to be purchased. At the end of the day, I was like a limp dish rag after moving all this stuff around and building new things. Marcia looked at her watch and she said, "We don't really have time to do your upstairs. I'll have to come back for that," she said. Marcia gave us 52 delightful, exciting, whirlwind years. It was quite a ride for all who knew her. And then she left us. As Neil so eloquently and succinctly put it in the email he sent out last week, I have it with me. It says, sent Thursday, September 8th, 2005, 9:08 a.m. Subject, Marcia. Here's what he says. Marcia passed away peacefully sometime between 4 and 5 this morning. True to form, she slipped away quietly in the early morning hours of a very peaceful night without bothering anyone. So I guess the time really has come to say farewell, to bring things to some kind of closure, as the therapists would have it. I'd like to do it with a couple of poems that I feel speak simply but powerfully to the occasion. Marcia, you may know, liked poetry. Being the creative person she was, Marcia wrote a fair amount of poetry herself. And according to one entry in her memories, she says, when I was younger, she said, I used to sit and read poetry for hours. Now, I don't really know if the poem I'm about to share with you was among Marcia's favorites, but I think, like Neil's email from last Thursday, it succinctly and beautifully sums some things up. It sums up the simple and yet profound faith that Marcia found so sustaining. You might think of the poem as a farewell word from Marcia to you. The poem is by Emily Dickinson, and it goes like this. I never saw a moor, I never saw the sea, yet know I how the heather looks and what a wave must be. I never spoke with God nor visited in heaven, yet certain am I of the spot as if the chart were given. In the end, that really was Marcia's faith, you know. Like the woman at the well, she had come to know Jesus' soul-sustaining love. It was the one thing she never doubted. May God bless us with such a faith. As for right now, I think it's important that we too be given a chance to say a word of farewell to Marcia. Many took that opportunity last night at the funeral home. I'd like to give all of us a chance to do it together today. My suggestion is that we do it by together reciting a simple but powerful poem. As for the words, don't worry. You'll know them. Trust me. It's a poem in the form of a prayer. So consider it a poem, a prayer, a gift from you to Marcia. It's what you would have said had you been there in the early hours of morning between 4 and 5 o'clock last Thursday. I invite you then, if you would, join me as we bow our heads and close our eyes and fold our hands and say together the words our mothers taught us. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Amen.
Thank you.
God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Lord, we do give you thanks this day for Marcia and the gift she was to her family, her friends, her congregation, and parishioners, to all who knew and loved her. Comfort them in their grief and rejoice with them that her battle has ended. And if when I say, Lord, in your mercy, you would respond, hear us, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion in the body of Christ our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy. Yes. Gracious God, there are countries torn apart by war and homes especially devastated by the hurricane Katrina, let our hearts be compassionate, our spirits generous, and our hands eager helpers to those in need. Lord, in your mercy. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in you, O God, and all that you give us. We pray for those who suffer, body, mind, and spirit, especially those who we name silently before you now. Be their strength in weariness and their comfort in the dark of night and their joy each day. Lord, in your mercy. God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light, and we give you thanks because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave thanks, and gave it for all to eat, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." And the Lord's Prayer will be sung. This is a favorite of Marcia's, and I love to sing it as well, so we'll sing the Lord's Prayer.
Thank you.
I will invite those four of you helping to come up today. Communion is by intinction. It's just a fancy word that means you're going to be given a little piece of bread, and you will simply dip that into the cup of wine, and then you can return to your seats. We've got two stations, so this side will come up to here, go back around the side. This side will come up to here, go back around the side. Okay? All who come, any baptized believer, is welcome to come to the table. We will all sing "To God Be the Glory," and that the words will be on the screen. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Lloyd, do you want to join me, please? Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Marcia. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Lord, bless the food as well, the lunch that we will eat. Make it so our bodies will be strong and we will enjoy the fellowship and the time together as well. Amen. Thank you. We will sing the closing hymn that Marcia picked, "How Great Thou Art," and Rebecca will start. Sorry, from here? Okay, great. We won't start till you cue us, okay? All right, we won't start till you cue us. And you'll need to turn in your hymnals, 532. The words are not on the screen. 532 in your hymnals, sorry.
I see the stars, I hear the mighty.
Stand.